With me in the studio this afternoon from Shield Therapeutics, I'm joined by Carl Sterritt. Carl, good afternoon. Good to see you.
Good afternoon, Andrew.
We spoke on Friday, that big news from the FDA as to Feraccru. Just give us a quick recap on what it all means. I mean, all systems go as far as the US market is concerned.
Yes, I think fantastic news for us, really. We were delighted. So the drug has been given an approval for the treatment of iron deficiency in adults. So it's about as broad as you could possibly get. We think that there's 8 to 9 million iron deficiency anemia patients in the United States, but probably 2 to 3 times that with iron deficiency. And generally, if you treat the iron deficiency, you prevent the anemia. So I think it's an enormous opportunity, and we were delighted. And years of hard work, and so it was great to get the nod.
So as they say, a big de-risking event for the company.
I think so, yeah. I think one would have to say that the technical risk has largely disappeared, hasn't it? Certainly around Feraccru. Of course, we have other assets which we can touch on, but certainly around Feraccru, yes. It's now been approved by the European regulator with a very broad label, then the Swiss regulator with a very broad label, and now, of course, what some would probably say is the gold standard, even though I think Europe and the US are interchangeable. But with the FDA giving the same broad label, I think it's a real pointer towards the tolerability of Feraccru and also the efficacy of it.
What's it competing against? What's it going up against in the US?
Well, I think the treatment paradigm generally is to treat with orals first and then follow up. If a patient struggles with an oral therapy, then the current standard of care would be to put them onto intravenous iron of one form or another, and there's one that sort of dominates the market, with sales globally of about $1 billion at the moment. Sales in the US are probably around about $500 million a year. And the US market alone is worth $1 billion. So it's got quite a large percentage of that market. The role that Feraccru can play, because of its tolerability and also its effectiveness at treating iron deficiency, not just anemia, and I would look at anybody with anemia now as a treatment failure. They shouldn't get that far. They should be treated for their iron deficiency before the anemia happens. And Feraccru can now come into those patients who perhaps are struggling with the existing oral therapies because of their very well-known side effect profiles that limit their usefulness. And those patients would otherwise go onto intravenous iron. Well, that no longer needs to be the case. They can now be treated straight away with Feraccru. And of course, we've got the head-to-head data that we announced earlier this year versus intravenous iron, that leading product, which is doing $500 million a year in the US. And we've shown that Feraccru, in a technical sense, is non-inferior, as the technical term is non-inferior to Injectafer. Now, I should add, of course, that Feraccru is called Accrufer in the US. That's how it'll be known and when it gets marketed.
And this would be an out-of-hospital treatment, would it?
Both and. So realistically, it's going to be used mostly in patients who are ambulatory rather than inpatients in hospitals. But certainly, hospital specialists and office-based specialist physicians will be the initial prescribers. And through the clinical trials we've done in the US, we have about 50 centers, both office-based physicians and hospital-based physicians, who have used the product already. So they'll certainly be our sort of initial go-to people who can talk about the product from their own experience. They can help educate the wider market for us together with the commercial partner that we eventually choose.
And on that topic, how are those discussions? I'd imagine they're fairly advanced, are they?
Yeah, so we started a couple of months ago. We didn't want to do this too early. You always run the risk, I think, of doing something too early and then you get to a point where you're waiting for the FDA's announcement and people get bored or something else comes along, strategies change, etc. So we've been trying to build momentum up to that point and we certainly have quite a lot of interest. And I would expect that the news that came out on Friday will only bolster that interest. So we look forward to trying to get something done as quickly as possible. I think we've said previously, trying to get something done by the end of the year, I think is reasonable. Clearly, we want to get this done as quickly as possible.
Hypothetically, how would a deal such as this look? Would you be talking upfront payments and share of revenues?
Yes, so certainly an upfront payment. And I think we would be looking for a material upfront payment for a couple of reasons. First of all, obviously, it'd be nice to have the cash for the business. And I think that would enable us perhaps to push forward with our second asset as well, which needs another study. but also I think from the commitment it shows for the other party. You know, if they were to put a substantial payment down, they've got to earn that money back, as well as all of the costs of commercialization, etc. So that having them put real skin in the game. If a deal is all back-ended, if it's successful, then great. You know, royalties are fantastic. It just kicks off cash for a long time. But if they were to change their strategy, or something else was to happen outside of the role of Feraccru, and it's just a royalty deal and they lose their interest, then you know, we're sort of left high and dry, aren't we? And yes, you can put clauses in contracts that maybe you get the product back. But actually, I think the best way to do this is just make sure that there's skin in the game right from the outset. And of course, share in the upside, which we believe will be very significant with the numbers of patients, the indication we've been given.
And so the ideal partner here would be a company who've, within their own portfolio, have some similar drugs?
I think we would like to see a company that, a partner that has a focus initially on specialty care, so specialty prescribing, so rather than primary care, general practice, because I think we have to win. There is certainly in the market, as we did the clinical trials, we saw that people think, oh, oral irons don't work, so I'll use IV. And oral irons cause lots of problems. Well, Feraccru clearly rewrites that rule book, but we've got to get that message across. And generally, you want to get the message across and convince the what would be known as the key opinion leaders before you then cascade that out to the primary care physicians. So we're going to be looking for a company that has a focus initially, or we clearly are looking for a company that has that focus initially on those specialist prescribers. So they're working within hospitals, etc.
And you were telling me on Friday, from a pricing perspective, you'd expect it to command a premium to what you're getting in the UK?
Yes, I think, you know, that's sort of the general rule. And I said in my quote and in our press release on Friday that the US is the largest and best and the most attractively reimbursed market in the world. And even with what's going on around the US at the moment with President Trump, and there's been some focus around healthcare costs. But this is, we're not talking about a product here that is going to be $20,000, $30,000, $40,000, $50,000 a year. We're talking about a product that's going to be a few hundred dollars a month. You know, it's on a different order of magnitude. And critically, every patient that would go onto Feraccru is somebody that would be saving all the administration costs of intravenous iron as well. So it's a cost-effective therapy, no matter what.
And conservatively speaking, if you could get a deal done by the end of this year, how soon would it be available and on the market in the States?
First half of next year. I think it's hard to give anything more specific than that. But clearly we want to get whoever we work with, we want them to get on with it as quickly as possible. You've got to give them some time to get themselves educated, get their sales teams educated, start doing some medical education within the marketplace as well. I think it's important in the US that you hit the market hard. You don't want to do a sort of a slow build launch. You want them to go full on right from the outset and make as much noise as possible.
I want to speak for a moment about your other asset, which hasn't been making a lot of noise lately, PT20, living in the shadows of Feraccru to some degree. Just give us a quick recap on what this is focusing on.
So this came from really when we were a company that was going to try and build our own commercial operations. So we had Feraccru, and I've referred to Feraccru before as a backbone product. And it's a product that, because a number of diseases have iron deficiency as part of the issue, Feraccru, if you had Feraccru, then you could add other products to it, cardiology or renal or gastro, etc. So we licensed in some technology from the Medical Research Council's tech transfer arm in the UK, which is now called LifeArc. And it's a treatment for a disease called hyperphosphatemia. So it's very high levels of phosphate in your blood, which cause significant cardiovascular risk. And it happens in patients who've got quite advanced kidney disease, and they no longer can excrete the phosphate that they take in their diet. And we, in the Western world, phosphate is ubiquitous in our diet. It's, you know, if you have a ham sandwich, it's been used to protect the ham or to flavor it as well. It's in cans of Coke. It's in everything, really. And if you're healthy and you have got fairly normal kidneys, you just get rid of it. But if you've got kidneys that don't work very well, then you end up retaining it with all those associated problems. So the idea for us was Feraccru would be sold into nephrologists, and so would, on that backbone theory, so would PT20. But clearly that's an asset now that we'll be looking to advance further. It's been sitting on the back burner because we've been so focused on Feraccru, both from a manpower and a financial perspective. But hopefully now if we get a deal done in the US, some of that upfront payment we'll then be able to use to do the second pivotal study that's needed for PT20. So we've already done one pivotal study, which was clearly positive. We're doing a bit of work at the moment already just to finish the formulation that we would use in the second pivotal trial, because that's the formulation that would then go on to be the initial commercial formulation. Mm. So we would hope that we'll be ready to start that study in 2020, and that should also be on the back of a license deal for Feraccru in the US, which would then fund that program.
And what can you say about the competing assets for PT20? What kind of numbers are they generating?
So like most disease areas, there's a generic element to the market, which we would not compete against. You know, I think we've got a product that is novel and is in a different class. It's under patents, etc. The big player in the field has been a product called Sevelamer, from Genzyme, which is now Sanofi. That's recently gone off patent. And then the new class of drugs, and actually, before I got to the new class, that was at peak, that was probably over $1 billion a year in sales in the US. Mm. And then more recently, there are a couple of iron-based products, of which PT20 is also iron-based. But unlike Feraccru, it doesn't get well absorbed. The idea of the drug is that it binds the phosphate from the food in the gut and then gets passed through the gut. Whereas obviously the aim of Feraccru is to be absorbed. So although it's iron-based, it works in a completely opposite way. But it's a very effective binder of phosphate. And the two products that have recently come onto the market, which are also iron-based, which we believe Feraccru has some really significant advantages over. Sorry, PT20 has some really significant advantages over. Currently are both doing over $100 million a year in the States alone and growing quite effectively. So it's clearly an attractive market. Mm. And I think it's something that, because of the focus on Feraccru, we've not really talked about it. And I certainly don't think it's really baked into any of the valuations around the business as well.
Well, given the scale of the news last week on Feraccru, getting into the States,
yeah,
a development many investors waiting for, what do you reckon is going to be the next valuation uplift? What's going to kick the share price along? What are the next big milestones here?
Well, I would hope in the next near term, it's the news that happened on Friday really settling in and people working out their models and seeing what a huge impact. I think there was an expectation that Feraccru would get a very narrow label, perhaps for the treatment of iron deficiency anemia, just in CKD or just in IBD, maybe in both. So I think the fact that it got an approval in iron deficiency and the size of that market, if you think IDA in all indications, 8 to 9 million patients in the US, perhaps 2 to 3 times that with iron deficiency. So the opportunity is enormous, and that people are going to have to work out how that impacts the valuation of the business. Beyond that, I think then it's probably the license deal that we will do in the US. And of course, I've talked previously about ourselves being a way down the track with regard to doing a deal in China. And I think the news on Friday, it only helps all of those things because it's such a positive piece of news.
Indeed. And you must be due for a trading update held shortly, aren't
you? Yeah, so our interims are due, which will come out in the next few weeks, within the timelines that we would normally give them. So it's not something we've held back or anything. They'll just come out as planned.
And that'll effectively reflect developments in sales in the UK and Germany.
Yes, it will. So if you go back to the deal we did with Norgine, and I've talked about this before, that initially their focus is on commercializing Feraccru in the markets where the drug already had a price. Mm. And we'd all been waiting for the head-to-head data to be able to then seek a price in all of those, the majority of European markets that are price givers rather than price takers. And we felt that head-to-head data, and Norgine shared this opinion, that it was really essential for that data to be used to create a premium price or protect the price in Germany and the UK, etc., that we've already achieved. So, we've never really expected there to be significant sales. I think we're looking for increases in sales rather than numbers, because the numbers are still quite small. But if we can see that Norgine are progressing well and call rates and all those sorts of things that you'd look to use as your metrics that will then create the snowball that causes the snowball to roll down the hill, for me, that's really the key set of elements I'm looking for and have been looking for in our interactions with Norgine. And as I've said before, you know, we think they're doing a good job. So we're very happy with the progress they're making and the foundations that's laying for the future.
Well, clearly a significant first half of the year and an even busier second half in store for you.
Yeah, it's bad, but you know, Friday was enjoyable, and it's I've had some bad days, so as a CEO, so it's nice to have some good days as well. And I think also something that was very gratifying, the healthcare sector in the UK has taken a battering, and you know more than most because you interview most of the CEOs, I guess, and you probably have some quite gloomy faces sitting here at times. And so I think for the sector, I think this is great. And because success begets success, and there are tons and tons of fantastic ideas out there, and people are struggling to get financing. And if some people make some money from this, then they'll recycle that money, hopefully, at some point. Not too soon, but you know, hopefully they'll recycle that money at some point. Which will go back into research and development projects to create the next set of products. So it can only be good for the sector.
Carl, good to see you as always. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much.